Tuesday morning, totally Tuesday, hanging out with my Alicia and Koch, quarter past 8 o'clock, and it's not a normal. It's been a pretty interesting last few weeks. All kinds of superstars in the building, and we have another one here with us, a legend in the making.
Yes,
indeed. We're gonna work at Koch. You want to do the honors? We've got Jimmy as well, our own in-house legend.
Yes,
and we got Moses as well, and we got. Who we got in the studio, Koch?
We got Super Eagles captain Joseph Yobo.
Yes, sir! Yes, sir! Big up, big up, big up, big up. Nice one, nice one. Well done. All right, welcome to our world. How you doing? How you feeling?
Yeah, very well, thank you.
Yeah? So you've been a busy man. What have you been up to lately?
Just following up with my team, the Super Eagles, because I can play.
Yeah.
Been injured, so right now I think my vacation starts. So I'm here in the country, staying with my family, and following up with a few things.
All right. So you've been in the camp with the rest of the team that were down in Calabar before the matches?
Yes, I have been. You know, I think I arrived before the first game to show my support to the team as a captain. And I was thinking I was gonna be fit for the last game, but they went to Malawi, so I stayed behind, you know, to step up my fitness.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I couldn't make it, but I'm just happy that, you know, the three games went well, and hopefully we're looking forward to the next stage.
All right, what's the nature of your injury? Can we just know this?
Yeah, I had a hamstring injury. It was supposed to take about 4 weeks, and I'm feeling better now. I think if we had a game this week, I'll be okay to play, but I'm happy that, you know, we did well even without me being there.
All right, fantastic. We have the captain of the Super Eagles, Joseph Yobo, with us. We have our own man, Jimmy, here. Jimmy, you got any questions? Want to throw it? If you want to ask any questions, Facebook or Twitter, please hit us up. And also our phone line, 01463-1700-1701 and 01270-1020. Jimmy!
Yes, yes, yes. I do have a series of questions to ask you. A lot of people have been wondering how you have made the transition from the English Premier League to the Turkish League. How has that experience been for you? I mean, we do know you've had a long spell at Everton, and you were very much a cult hero at the club. What did it take for you to leave? I mean, leaving such a club that had such huge following and tradition, and then you had to change base and go all the way to Turkey. Just tell us about that transition from the Premier League to the Turkish League.
Yeah, I think, you know, been in the Premier League for 7 years with Everton, I knew I needed a change as well, you know, because I needed to challenge myself, and then the opportunity came to join Fener on loan. Fener is a huge club, and going to Turkey. When I first went, I knew about the club, but not about Turkey as a whole, so it was a little bit difficult, but when I started playing, then I realized that I'm playing for a huge team. The fan base is amazing, and you know, I think I'm privileged to play for them. So the transition was pretty easy because you know, I think we adapted quickly to each other. Me playing, the fans, the club, the people in Turkey, the lifestyle. I think I loved every moment of it. I have no regrets living in the Premier League because for me, Fener is one of the biggest teams in the world.
It wasn't to do with the tax-free payment.
Of course, money is important, but the most important thing for me was, you know, staying with Everton. I don't know if I had a chance of winning the championship or playing in the Champions League. So when I went to Fener, I know I always had that. You know, last season I won the championship. My first season, the second season I lost the championship on the last day and won the FA Cup. So it's just about me achieving something as a footballer, having a trophy, which I've had two now in two seasons. So I'm happy. As I say, of course, money is important. My family is well settled in time.
Because we know that it was going to be very hard to win the Premier League with Everton.
That didn't ever happen.
That would be when hell freezes over. All right, Jimmy, any more questions?
Right, I mean, away from your club history, now let's move on to the Super Eagles. Stephen Keshi is the coach of the Super Eagles at the moment. People have been waxing lyrical about their opinion in terms of what the Super Eagles looks like now. I mean, the formula being implemented, having 50% of the team locally based and the other 50% from the foreign legion. How do you see that playing out? And do you think it's a good way of getting Nigeria's best out?
Yeah, you know, I'm in full support of what he's doing. You know, he's my boss, I'm the captain, and we speak a lot, and we share the same, you know, opinion on things that we're doing. I think it's, you know, I'm in support of him giving the local-based players opportunities because they bring something different. You know, the foreign-based players, we have our experience, and you know, we are used to the big stage. But the local based players, I think we have some very good players, which they're proven now. They played like 3-4 games, so I think it's a good blend to have the local base and the experienced players. And some experienced players are missing out, but it doesn't mean they're out of the team. Mm. You know, he's experimenting, and I think every game is going to give some players their opportunity. And it's all about competition as well. If you have the opportunity, then you don't take it, then you might be left out. And this is a national team. We've not been doing very well in the past year. So Keshi, he's a big boss. He's been the captain. He's coming in. He came in, and he's sitting on the pressure seat. So he knows he wants to revive Nigerian football. He wants the team to achieve something. I, as a footballer, have been there for almost over a decade. I want to win something. It's about winning something now. So if you are not ready to play for the national team, then I think that it's going to, no matter how talented that you are, because I think local-based players are giving us, you know, a top competition.
All right, what about the argument of local or foreign coach? Are you very much in favor of having Keshi in charge, or do you think that Nigerian coach is not ready? Because the argument is still going on.
Yeah, right now, I know I'm in full support of Keshi. I've seen what I've played under him before, and now he's back, you know, he's coached other countries. So he has the experience. He's not just a coach.
Right.
For me, I've seen his managerial skills, so he blends that together, being a coach and being a manager. And most important thing is he has a good management skill as well. So I think he is the right person now, because the result speaks for itself. I wasn't there as the captain. He's managed to get 2 wins out of 3 and 1 draw. So
not bad. Pretty good stuff. All right, we're going to take some online questions.
Yes,
for a lot of your fans out there.
Mm-hmm. Question coming in on Twitter now. Olarin Wajido says, "Good morning, Yobo. Wish you the best in life. But do you think the Nigerians have Nigeria has the right players to qualify for the World Cup and Nations Cup?"
Yes, I think we do. I think we have a whole. We're blessed. Nigeria is blessed with so many, many players. And what the coach is doing, the local-based players are here, and he's also mixing it up with the foreign-based experienced players. So I think we have everything. It's about dedication, and you know, we have a coach that wants to bring out the best in every player.
Okay. Duro Jai Ajibola on Facebook says, "What are you doing for the grassroots players in the country?"
Yeah, I have a program coming up. You know, but it's very hard that when I'm not around to have somebody to oversee what the plans that I have.
Right.
But now I'm in the country, I'm putting a lot of things together, and hopefully in the future I'll be raising the grassroots as well, because we need to find another Yobo. We need to find the top players. JJ is out, Kano is out, there are still no replacements.
You started as a striker, so how did you manage to change your defender? I remember when you were in the junior teams, you were a striker, weren't you?
Yeah, I think I started from the midfield,
really?
But they said that potentially I could play anywhere on the pitch. So in the junior team, when I started, the coach fixed me there. But I think I was very, very versatile with the talent that I had. But initially, my position was defensive midfield.
Okay, nice one. All right, we got Moses, arguably the best looking guy in Super Sport. I'm sure Charles would argue with that, and maybe even Victor Kweba would argue with that as well. I know Ndukai Bale would not.
Okay, you are stirring up the honest list. All right, good to be here, Lisa. Thank you very much for having us. Mm-hmm. And my first time on Big Net FM. It's a really beautiful place. Huh?
Thank you.
You know, good stuff you guys are doing here. I was a bit offended when you were introducing everybody as a legend, and I'm thinking,
no, you're a legend in the making, you know. Just like Jimmy, just like Koch. Joseph Yobo is already a legend. He doesn't have to do anything again. He's done it already.
Noted.
On different continents.
Noted.
So what's your involvement? What's Super Sport doing with Joseph Yobo?
Well, not necessarily Super Sport per se. But again, it's a good platform for him since I'm there. But more or less managing his the media aspect, everything that has to do with Joseph Yobo. He's a brand in its own, and truly, he is a legend, as you have duly stated. So the whole idea is to give him a lot of presence, you know, because we realize after football, our footballers just literally fade off.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it just doesn't make a lot of sense, because you still have many of these foreign footballers, if you look out, going into punditry, some of them going into other aspects of media. And, you know, they're still relevant. And that's the whole idea why Joseph Yobo is here this morning. The whole idea is that beyond football, you know, there are other aspects he's also into. And don't be surprised, there are other things he's coming up with.
Yeah.
Really, really big stuff. And we will be involving you in that.
Okay.
But we're still under wrap as it is.
Okay, fantastic. Got to ask you, Joseph, you've got like about 90 caps by now, almost like 87, 88.
Yeah,
somewhere around that figure. Did you ever get to play, you know, with Yakini at all? I know it was different generation. what do you think of what happened to you, Rashid Yakini? What's your take on it?
He's a legend. I wish I did, but you know, they were way older than me. You know, he's a legend. I watched him play, and it's so sad that I never met him in person. Mm-hmm. I heard a lot about him, and he's always gonna be up there. I mean, he's so rest in peace. I think it's a sad situation that ex-footballers, when they finish, we're the young ones, you know. After them, we're always in Europe, so we don't know what is going on here. But those that are here, I think they could have helped his situation. This is somebody that put his life out there for his country, served his nation so well, and he was having problem, and people never came to his rescue. I don't know, maybe one or two might have tried. But the way he passed away is so sad, and we just lost the legend.
Now, we heard some players did try and reach out to him, some, you know, perhaps some members of the football community, but somehow they couldn't get to him, you know. So there's a lot of mystery surrounding what happened. We're still waiting to clarify. All right, we're going to be running up soon. Jimmy, what's up?
Well, in line with the question you just asked, I mean, I don't think anybody would let me go scot-free if I don't ask this question. You've been with the Super Eagles through a long process, I mean, different sets of players, different coaches, different orientation in different ways. People have said at some point in time the players were more concerned about playing for their clubs rather than playing for the national team. Players were more concerned about, you know, they're not as committed when playing for Nigeria because there's no welfare afterwards. If you get injured for the national team, it's difficult for you to get back into your club side, and then the club side is the one that actually plays. You know, the whole story like that. So my question is, why do you think it is perceived that the players are not as committed when they're playing for the national team?
Yeah, I think it's not really about commitment, because the first thing is you accepting to leave your club and travel all the way down. You know, that's commitment. You can easily turn the invitation down that you're not coming. But then when you get down here, it's about discipline. And I don't think in the past the team has been so united. We've been apart. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not together as a family, and that's been our biggest problem. It's not about commitment. And also, the facility doesn't help.
True.
You know, there are other things that we can talk about and things that have to be put together. But the most important thing is, you know, if we stay together, we are so talented. This is what Keshi is trying to do right now. And we've been at the Nations Cup semifinals. We always lose, and the third place game, we get the bronze medal. So it's time to change all that. And I think the players that accept to come to camp are committed. But then when we come to camp, we are not united, and this is what myself and Keshi were trying to do.
All right, fantastic. Got to ask you, club and country. Now, for club, who's the best player you played with for your clubs? All the clubs you played.
Oh, that's a hard one. That's a very, very hard one.
Okay, who's been most, on the club level, your most difficult opponent to mark?
So many. So many.
What about playing for Nigeria? Who were you? You know, because I used to hear some stories about in the old days when, you know, when Nigeria used to play against Ghana. Yeah. So there will be, you know, my dad told me these stories that when Emmanuel Okala was in goal and Christian Chukwu was defender, there was a particular Ghanaian striker called Mensah that the Nigerian players feared. So whenever he had the ball, Okala and Chukwu started speaking in Igbo. They were afraid with the guy. So who was your most fearsome opponent you had to face? Who you like, when is Nigeria's turn to play against this guy? You're like, you're not looking forward to that match?
As I said, for me, I've always played against the top players, so I don't really like pick one in mind. But I will go back to the club side. I think when I was in the Premier League, it's every time I play against Thierry Henry, I knew that something was up.
Yeah.
And then he brought out the best in me as well, because he pushes me to the limit. That, you know, he can win games by himself, you know, so that makes me step up. Like, I literally have to prepare like over a week to play against him.
You have to say some prayers as well.
Yeah, because he had everything at that time, and I think at that time he brought out the best in me every time I play against him as well.
Well, you have to say, Arsenal fans are actually gloating now.
Just he's not there anymore. So I think you did pretty well against him. He didn't run right against Everton when you were there. So
he knows, and he was good. He was good, but you know, he's a legend. So for me, I was happy that I played against one of the best.
All right, we better wrap it up soon.
All right, one more question from Facebook. Samzi Samoko Olajide says, Captain Yobo, what do you think of the Nigerian Premier League at the moment, and what do you think can be done to improve it?
Yeah, this is something that I don't have much knowledge of, okay. But I'm just saying the local player because I didn't play in the Nigerian League.